Welcome, everybody, and a very warm welcome indeed to this webinar on population, food, and the environment. This webinar is organized by the International Union for the Scientific Study of Population, IUSSP, of which I have the honor to be Secretary General and Treasurer. And if you're not a member, you are, of course, very much welcome to join us. My name is Nico van Inwegen. And we at IUSSP are extremely happy and proud that we organized this webinar in collaboration with our friends and colleagues from the Population Association of America, the PAA. This is a first joint webinar. Let's hope more will follow and this will be the start of a new tradition. Before we start, here are some practical tips that you have also seen on your screen, but just as a reminder. You can join the discussion by using the Q&A feature at the bottom of your screen. So put your questions there, use that feature and do not use the chat. We will be crowdsourcing the questions. So if you see a question that you particularly like, give it a thumbs up and the question will move up the row and has a higher probability to be answered. If you write your question, add the name of the speaker to which the question is addressed. And you can also use the raise hand function and we will try to pick up that in the discussion as well. Now we have many participants, so do forgive us if it's not possible to answer your question directly. Note that this webinar will be recorded. You can view everything at ease at a later stage and it is now live streamed through YouTube. And later it can be viewed through the IUSSP website. Last thing, at the bottom of your screen, you see the live transcript button. If you click that one, you can see the transcripts at your screen. And you can read what we are saying. And as you have already noticed, we are recording this webinar. So back to the webinar. The links between population, population dynamics, population growth, resources, food production, have of course intrigued population scientists for centuries and fueled the debate among optimists and pessimists since the days of Thomas Malthus. So our webinar stands in a very long tradition, which is a very big challenge. And we hope today to add new evidence and bring new insights to this debate. We do so with a prime set of speakers and with your inputs as attendees. The debate after the presentations will be, and the discussion will be moderated by Luan Yang. Luan is director of the Asian Demographic Research Institute in Shanghai, and he is also a senior associate of the Population Council. Luan, over to you, back to business.
Thank you very much, Nicole, and welcome to the joint webinar. I'm very glad to have the opportunity as join the panel to discuss population, food, and the environment. The relationships between population and the environment has been attracting increasing attention from scholars, policymakers, and the publics. How would a human society provide enough food for the growing population is always the fundamental question and always at the core of debate, starting from the early days of Thomas Malthus, as Nico mentioned. Well, after 450 years, we know now that population growth does not necessarily always surpass food growth. And the human society have achieved great progress in alleviating poverty and hunger. The world is still facing many challenges to food security, such as environmental degradation, climate change, population growth, social inequality. A pandemic crisis could undo many years of progress. So these factors all affect the food supply and the food demand and lead to the uncertainties of food price. Today, this webinar engages different views on social, economic, and environmental consequences of population growth through presenting the outcome of a bet on food prices between two panelists, David Lam and Sam Becker. 10 years ago, following David's presidential address at the 2011 PAA meeting, our roundtable will discuss With this, start with David and Stan, who will first state their arguments. Surely most of economists at the Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations will introduce the food price index and reveal the results of the wager. That will be followed by the reflections from David and Stan. We then invite John Bongotz and Roya Motorek comment from the broader population, social and environmental context before we open the floor for Q&A. Without further ado, we now invite our first panelist, David Lam, to state his argument. David is a professor of economics at the University of Michigan. David, you now have the floor for 5 minutes. Turn to you.
Okay, thank you very much. Great pleasure to be here with everybody. Thanks very much to IUSSP and the PAA for organizing this event. I am, give me a thumbs up that you can see my screen there. Okay,
yes.
All right. Okay, so I'm gonna present a bit of an optimistic perspective. And this event partly is a follow-up from my presidential address to the Population Association in April 1st of 2011. I highlighted the date here because, of course, that was April Fool's Day, and I could say that I shouldn't be responsible for anything I said that day. But in fact, going back over my address, I still feel very much the same as I did then, and I'll present some evidence today of why that is the case. So let me just review a bit about what I said in that presidential address very quickly, just a few of the highlights. It was motivated in part by the fact that the world was hitting a 7 billion population in 2011, which was an increase from 3 billion people in 1960. The world's population growth rate had peaked at around 2.1% per year in 1965 or so. This was absolute unprecedented population growth that had never seen before and will never be seen again. And my focus was on how the world did in three main areas of concern. Would we be able to feed everyone? Would we run out of resources? And would poverty increase? And these were not just straw man concerns, of course, but very real concerns that were being expressed in the 1960s. One example being Paul Ehrlich's book, The Population Bomb, where he said the world, especially the developing world, is rapidly running out of food. In fact, the battle to feed humanity is already lost in the sense that we will not be able to prevent large scale famines in the next decade or so. And there were very many others who had quite dire predictions about food and hunger and starvation and poverty and resources in the coming decades and as a result of the population growth. So what actually happened? I did a sort of whirlwind. These are some actual slides from the from my address. So food production in the world had increased more than three times. So these are indexed to 1961. So 313 means the world was producing 3.1 times as much food in 2011 or 2010, 2009 here was the last year I had data for at that time, as in 1961 from the Food and Agricultural Organization's data. Population had increased 2.2 times, more than doubled, but food production clearly growing faster than population, with per capita food production increasing by 41%. If we looked at particular countries, India was a country particularly singled out by Paul Ehrlich and others as a place that would have mass starvation. In fact, there was some difficulty keeping per capita food production even through the 1960s, but then we had these very rapid increases of the Green Revolution, and food production by 2009 was 3.6 times higher than in 1960. Population was 2.6 times higher, so per capita food production had actually increased by 37%. Africa had had a bit more trouble. population increased faster than food production, though food production increased remarkably fast. But per capita food production in 2009 was actually 7% lower than in 1960. I showed this graph of poverty, which had been declining quite steadily based on World Bank data. Here's poverty for different regions. It had declined in every region. In recent years, though, in sub-Saharan Africa, the decline was modest relative to 1981 when the data first began. So overall, very good progress on both food and poverty. On resources, I presented this quote from Julian Simon in his book, Ultimate Resource, who had offered to have a wager about the prices of food, of raw material resources. Paul Ehrlich took him up on the bet, and I showed this fairly well known now result that the real cost of every one of these five minerals declined, and Paul Ehrlich and his colleagues ended up writing a check to Julian Simon, and that was partly inspired the wager that Stan and I will talk about today. In fact, when you look at the whole series of mineral of metals prices, you can see that Simon got kind of lucky. In fact, mineral prices are very volatile, and in fact, he just happened to catch a period when they were going down. But on the other hand, there was a general trend downward, offset by this increase here right around the time of my address. So let me just say quickly about food prices. This is what food prices were looking like along with all non-energy commodities. You can see this big downward trend with the exception of the OPEC spike here down to about 2000, and then a big increase right up until about the time of my address. And that was the something I talked about in my address, was this increase here that had just been happening. And we can see that there was a very sharp increase in food prices here from 2000 to January 2011, which was the last time I had data for my address. And I said I thought that food prices would probably return to their overall downward trend. And that led to the bet that we will talk about today. So I'll return with some follow-up comments after Stan has talked and we've talked about the wager. Thank you.
Thank you very much, David. Now we invite Stan Becker to state his argument of a more pessimistic view on food price. Stan is a professor emeritus of population, family, and reproductive health at Johns Hopkins University. Stan, you also have 5 minutes. You need to unmute yourself.
Okay, 1, 2, 3. Good day, I'm glad to be here. And I call this a more realistic perspective with a question mark because it'll be different than what you just heard. And I need to figure out how to advance. Okay, so this one of your shared application, hold on. It's got some message I didn't see yesterday. Anyway, so David presented about his presidential address, so I don't need to go over that. He showed all kinds of things were improving. The literacy increase as well, fertility and mortality down, and the ones he showed you about food production. So lots of positive trends in 2011. This graph he showed you about per capita and population and food. I've been in ecological circles for quite a while, and I felt how the world survived the population bomb wasn't quite right. I'm trying to move my thing here, hold on. Because the focus was on Homo sapiens, virtually ignored the rest of the world, if you will, and its ecosystems. In 28 pages in the article, he only had 1.4 pages of warnings about the future. And that was "Have We Really Survived" was a section, and only one paragraph on global warming and one on consumption levels out of 80 paragraphs. He described the Ehrlich-Simon bet, which you've heard. And so Simon won the bet. So Professor Lamb, David then challenged anyone in the audience for a similar wager later, and I responded and we worked out the details and the wager results will be presented shortly. So I also Demography published a commentary on his presidential, has the world really survived the population bomb? And in this, I looked at, first of all, economists tend to be optimist, I guess, but there are some problems with the discipline as we know it. First is they think market forces will take care of most things. Also, they seem to take natural resources for granted until they start running out, and then you go back to A and we have market forces. Third, they fail to take account of externalities or plan for externalities, and CO2 pollution is an excellent example of this. We've known for many years that CO2 is a problem, and yet we have not regulated it. It's an externality. Also, they tend to think continued growth is very good, is good and necessary. If you sell diapers, you want to sell more diapers than this next year than this year. So you tend to think growth would be good, more babies. And related to this, they fail to recognize that the earth is finite. So these errors in economics, ignoring the externality, for example, can lead to food insecurity. So five climate impacts we've already felt on food production. First is more extreme weather. Second, there's water scarcity. I list the US, but it's a problem in many parts of the world now. Seasons are not what they used to be. Wildfires and warmer weather and CO2 levels can adversely affect food supply, safety, and quality. So I finished in less than 5 minutes, but I may take 6 or 6.5 minutes in the next time. Thank you. And now we'll go on to the results of the wager.
Thank you, Stan. We now have the perspectives on the wager laid out from the both sides. As the food price wager uses the FAO food price index as its metric, we now invite Shirley Mostafa to introduce the methodology, data, and the scope of the index and review the outcome of the wager. Shirley is an economist at the Markets and Trade Division of FAO. Shirley, the floor is now yours. You have 10 minutes.
Thank you very much. And hello, everyone. I'm very pleased to be here and present the work of FAO, particularly as far as the work on the FAO food price index is concerned. Now, in the interest of time, let me just get straight to it. I don't want to overdo my welcome here. So allow me just a second. Just a second, please, while I work out these. Okay, now it doesn't look like I can. Give me a second, please. These buttons can be a little bit. There we go. Thank you. Now, let me begin with what the food price index essentially is. Well, it is a global indicator measuring prices of international foodstuffs over time. It was essentially introduced over 25 years ago in order to provide a metric of the state of agricultural, global agricultural markets. So its geographic scope is general and global, I should say, but I'll get a little bit more into this a little bit later, if you don't mind. Now, even though the food price index has by now really accrued some longevity, I have to really stress the fact that its structure has remained largely unvaried, and it has had only a few amendments since its inception in 1996. In terms of milestones, in fact, perhaps the first other than its inception was in 2006 with its incorporation in the FAO Food Outlook, which is the FAO flagship publication on global food markets. Now, as some of you following the market very closely may be well aware, 2006 is also a period that preceded what is now termed as the global food price crisis period of 2007 and 2008, when we had very marked surges in food prices. Now, it is during this period where, in fact, the food price index gained a great deal of notoriety and prominence. And in fact, demand for information such as the index, in fact, led to the introduction of a dedicated webpage in the FAO World Food Situation Portal to report its results on a monthly basis. Now, even though food prices, international food prices, have fluctuated a great deal over time since then, this notoriety of the index has persisted over time. And in fact, by now, it is often featured, or rather, it is regularly featured in over 400 top-tier media outlets. Now, in terms of revisions, the index has undergone three sets of revisions, most of which have, however, really been limited to updating its base period. And in fact, they have not been major at all. So just to go back to what I mentioned earlier, on the whole, the structure and form of the index has remained largely unvaried over time. Now, let me turn a little bit more into the architecture of the index. And perhaps here, one key aspect that is noteworthy is that the structure of the FAO Food Price Index, or FFPI, as we like to call it, is modular in nature, in that the overall food index is built from five sub-indices, which we refer to as the FAO Food Commodity Price Indices. Now, each of these indices represent a major foodstuff group that is globally traded, namely cereals, dairy products, vegetable oils, sugar, and meat. Now, sugar aside, each of these commodity groups indices is in turn built from a subset of indices that represent individual commodities or products, or at times even a fourth level of indices with a little bit more granularity, as is, for instance, the case of rice, which actually contains even varietal breakdowns. This is so in such a way that a total of 24 food commodities are taken into account in calculating the overall FAO Food Price Index. Now, getting into a little bit more of technical detail as far as the construction of the index goes, as I mentioned, the FFPI is modular and is essentially a weighted average of the FAO food commodity price indices. Now, the weights employed to aggregate them into the overall FFPI are the global average export shares of each of the food commodity groups in 2014 and 2016. This is the period that acts as a base for all of the indices. Now, we normally choose a three-year period to act as a base in order to minimize what atypical variations you may have in international trade or prices. Now, its form is a simple Laspierre's index. And when we report it in real terms, it relies on the World Bank's manufacturer unit value index as deflator. Now, as you can see perhaps from my previous slide, or as I mentioned, if you were following closely, I mentioned that there are 24 foodstuffs that are represented in the index, but that is not to say that we employ only 24 price series to measure food price movements. On the contrary, we use a total of 95 quotations to calculate the overall index. Now, these quotations are international export prices. They are spot quotations. We do not employ futures in the index, and this is in order to convey current market conditions. And each of these price series are selected and reviewed by FAO commodity market specialists. Now, the sources of these price series vary, but they're for the most part other international organizations, government agencies, or industry associations. Now, as you may see from this slide, I also make note of the fact that we invest the FAO a great deal of efforts in terms of ensuring the completeness and comparability of the underlying prices that go to compute the index. And I think this is worth highlighting, in part because part of the value of the index is that it builds from actual observation. Estimates from FAO commodity analysts are kept to a minimum, if not avoided altogether. Now, of course, this has its implications, particularly in terms of restricting the longevity of the series reported, and at times also its granularity, particularly from a temporal perspective. But this is not something that we can easily sidestep. Now, as with any indicator, really, the indices are subjected to periodic reviews, the latest of which, as I mentioned in my previous slide, took place last year. And this is, of course, in order to ensure the relevance of the metric, but also that the structure of global trade has not been altered significantly over time. Now, in terms of dissemination, the FAO food price indices were really developed to serve as a global public good. As such, they're disseminated in their entirety to the wide public through either dedicated web pages such as the World Food Situation Portal, or through publications such as the Food Outlook that I mentioned earlier, or commodity-specific bulletins. Now, in order to ensure the timeliness of the metric, we follow a very strict release schedule, which is prepared and disseminated well in advance. Now, these updates are monthly and normally fall on 10 at 10 a.m., I should say wrong time, and I kid you not, the schedule is that strict. Of the first Thursday of every month, unless of course the first Thursday is the first day of the month, in which case the releases roll over to the following Thursday. Now the updates obviously relay the latest index points for the nearest month that has most recently closed. And these are released in the form, of course, of a data set, but also a commentary relaying key price developments of that particular month. And all of this is released in six languages. Now, at this stage, it may be useful for me to highlight some limitations of the index, else I may risk portraying too positive of a picture. Now, of course, we try our best to run calculations solely on observed data, as I mentioned earlier, but reporting lags happen, life is such. So at times, analysts have to derive estimates of the most recent months. This implies that the most data points for the most recent months may at times be subject to revisions. Now, in terms of commodity coverage, the index encompasses the major food groups that are globally traded. But of course, they don't encompass all foodstuffs. And this is primarily the result of lack of complete or reliable data. Among the various limitations, though, that there may be in referring to the index, however, I should probably the most important caveats that are that may need to be highlighted in referring to the index are probably those related to price transmission and their or its food security implications, though. In that, keep in mind that the index is a metric of global food markets viewing developments from an international trade perspective. A gain or decline in the indices does not necessarily imply that such movements will be passed through to consumer prices at the national or subnational level. This is so because this type of a transmission will depend on a host of other factors, including the country in question's exposure to international trade for that specific commodity that is being looked at, aspects such as policies, the level of domestic availabilities. This is just to name a few of the variables that really go into dictating whether prices will be passed through. Now, in also keep in mind that in viewing price developments from a trade lens, the food price index assigns weights to the various commodities that compose it based on their contribution to global exports, which is not necessarily in line with the typical composition of a food basket. Now, two separate indices, namely the Global Food Consumption Price Indices, or GFCPIs, as we like to call them, for our love of acronyms, were actually developed to address this analytical need. Now, the GFCPIs are similarly composed or in terms of structure to the FFPI and also in terms of commodity coverage, even though some additional commodities are actually included in the GFCPIs. But critically, they differ from the FFPI in that they weigh the individual commodity prices using, or the individual commodity groups rather, I should say, using their specific contribution to average caloric or protein intake. And this, of course, is measured by the FAO World Food Balance Sheet. Now, before wrapping up, I should probably draw your attention to some recent trends. Now, as some of you may be well aware, international food prices and an international trade in food remain at the center of attention. This is all the more so in the current COVID-19 context. Now, as measured by the FAO Food Price Index in March 2021, global food prices, in fact, were at their highest level since June 2014. And much of this gain or this level gain has been the result of increases in prices of cereals and vegetable oils over the past year, but not only. Other commodity groups have also risen, with the exception really of meat. Now, despite these gains, I should note, however, that price levels of all commodity groups remain below the respective historical peaks. Now, if we were to view price developments from a broader temporal window and bring back the discussion to the reason that brings us all here today, We may actually note that global food prices, as measured by the FFPI and in real terms, have actually risen over the past decade, if compared to the average levels in 2001 through 2010. So to make the results of the wager more explicit, Professor Stan Becker is in fact the winner of the wager. I will now take a little bit of time just to draw your attention to the maths behind the winnings, or how the winnings were calculated based on the terms of the wagers decided by the two professors. And with that, I will close my intervention there, and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Shirley, to introduce the food price index and also review the outcome of the wager. And after this discussion, and now we will now invite David and Stan to react to the outcome. Stan, would you please go first?
I think David was first.
Huh? Oh, you want David to go first? Okay, David, you go first.
Yes.
You have 5 minutes.
You. Okay. I think I'm to go first because in part I'm to pay up. Here, in fact, you can see here, sorry, because I'm sharing my screen. I have a check here. Hard to see with my virtual background. There it is. I have a check here for $194, which is being made out to the Population Media Center. So the terms of our bet were that if Stan won, he would choose a population organization for me to donate to, and that's the one he chose. And you can read about it here. It's a very fine organization. I'm very, very happy to make the donation on Stan's behalf as a result of the wager. So I'll say a little bit more about the wager and what has happened since 2011, since I gave my presidential address. So quickly, world population has added another 7.8 billion people. Is up to 7.8 billion people. That's addition of another 850 million. The population growth rate has continued to decline. It's down to about 1% a year, and mainly that high because of population momentum, all the women in childbearing age. Some quick updates on what's happened in the three things I mentioned: food production, poverty, food prices. So did the good news end in 2011? Well, the answer is no. This is food production now extended all the way to 2018. You can see that it continues to grow faster than population in the world. Per capita food production is now 46% higher than in 1961. India has had phenomenal continued rapid growth of food production. Per capita food production is 64% higher than in 1961. And in sub-Saharan Africa, even food production has actually begun to outpace population, which was not true back in 2011. So per capita food production has actually been rising in Africa as well. So that's all good news. Poverty rates, these are somewhat different measures based on World Bank's new $1.90, which is an update of their old dollar a day. You can see massive declines in poverty by that estimate from 1981 to 2018. This is their most extreme poverty measure. And if we look at all the regions, East Asia, South Asia, Sub-Saharan Africa, three big important regions, see big declines in poverty. Now to the food price index. Let's just look at exactly what happened here between, I've indicated three dots here. This is 2001 to 2010. That was the first period that we used for our bet. And the bet was whether the average price in that period would be greater or lower than the average price in the recent period. So in a sense, I would say that we both won. I was actually right that food prices would not continue to go up. They have in fact gone down since 2011. I lost the bet, however, because they didn't go down fast enough to offset this big increase from 2001 to 2011. So there is a sense in which we're both right, but I'm not denying that I lost the bet. But just to look at the big picture, this is what food prices look like over time, and we can see that we're sort of back to a declining trend, although this recent spike, as Shirley pointed out in her very interesting comments. So a few final concluding points. Food production continues to grow faster than population. Poverty continues to fall. Food prices have actually fallen since 2011, though I lost the bet because they haven't fallen enough to offset the previous decade's increase. So there's still many reasons for optimism that we can feed another 3 billion people, keep food affordable, continue reducing poverty. So should we be worried about the future? And are economists in particular worried about the future? The answer, yes, we should be very worried. It's not going to be easy to feed all these people. It doesn't just take care of itself, and that's not the point. The point is we do have the capacity if we work hard at these things. In particular, economists are very worried about climate change and very worried about externalities. And as we teach in Econ 101, markets create very good incentives for some things like producing more food, and that's a huge success story. They do not produce good incentives to produce fewer greenhouse gases. So economists are in many ways perhaps more worried even than anyone else is, because we understand that this is an area where we need some kind of creative interventions. Markets alone are not going to solve the problem. Poverty reduction, food availability still very uneven around the world. Africa is continuing to have major challenges. So these are not easy problems. The point is there is optimism to think that we can handle them if we work at it creatively. Thank you.
Thank you very much, David. That's a great reflection. There are already several questions, some questions from Q&A, and people raised about issues that you have been talking about. Right, Stan, now it's your turn for your reaction. You also have 5 minutes.
A little more, please. thank you. So I have to get this up as well. Okay. So as David admitted, there are major things we have to be concerned about. The whole biosphere as we know it is in trouble. This is from FAO, 69% of fish stocks are fully exploited or overexploited. We've got massive extinction of other species among our own family of large primates. Only humans are not endangered. We've had massive decline of bee pollinators. Virtually all the best agricultural land is already under cultivation. Tropical forests are being destroyed at an alarming rate to make room for more soy, palm oil, beef cattle, and so on from increasingly eating world. And water drawn from aquifers is depleting aquifers very rapidly around the world. And world population is still growing by about 200,000 people per day. I tell my class we have 200,000 more people to feed tonight than last night. Whoops, I can't, there we go. Oh, see, okay, so here's a graph. Notice it's two different scales, but why it shows the way it does. Forest cover declining on from the left and population increasing. And it amounts to, we've added 2 billion people since 1992 and decreased our forest net, decreased 145 million hectares. So what's 145 million hectares? That's about the area of France, Germany, and Spain combined. Not a small problem. This is what it looks like in Indonesia. Massive destruction of forest for palm oil, which is in many of our foods that we eat every day. I looked at the literature. A group of ecologists, different groups of ecologists, have estimated how many people can be sustainably supported on our planet. And the estimates are here in the third column. You see from 2 to 3 billion, basically, and they all use slightly different methods. Now, indeed, the optimists may say, well, we'll get new energy sources. We'll figure out how to pull CO2 out of the air, hydroponics for food, and so on. But with what we know today, 2 to 3 billion is the population that can be supported sustainably. We're unsustainable at present. It's like a bank account where you're using the principal and not the interest. So how do we go from 8 billion persons today to 2 or 3 billion without a population crash? And degrowth is the answer, and I've given you the definition here, but so I don't take more time. You can look at it on your own. Basically, a reduction of energy and resource throughput. So I did a search for degrowth because David said the economists are very worried, and I looked, there were 108 articles, and 82 were in an ecological economics journal, which I recommend. However, in the traditional economic journals, the American Economic Review, American Economics Journal, there were zero. So I'm not sure where this concern is that Dave was talking about. Certainly ecological economics people are very concerned, but the traditional economists I couldn't find. I also did a search on carbon tax, and similarly, there were only two articles in the traditional economic journals. The IPCC report, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, reports food security is threatened. We have, they project 1 to 29% cereal price increase, increases of 1 to 183 million additional people risking hunger. Food system disruptions are growing with high confidence. So it's not like, so we're in trouble. What can we do? An example, I've looked at the literature as individuals, what can we do to reduce our carbon emissions? Because we have governments that haven't done much. Thankfully, we have a new president in this country who's going to be doing something. This is from a paper by Wines and Nichols. Nicholas adapted from an earlier paper, 2009, what individuals can do. So if we look at the first green one from the right, if we switch to vegetarian diet, we could each save about 1 ton of CO2 emissions per year. Moving further to the left, if we live without a car, very hard in this country, but if we can, we could, in the US, you see about 3 tons. And in Canada, about 2 point some tons. Look further on the left where there's a disjoint between, it's going up to about 60 tons per person if we have one less child. And the reason, of course, is because we have our emissions, but half of our child's emissions are ours, and a quarter go to us, and a quarter of our grandchildren, and so on. So the cumulative makes having one less child a very, very, very much more important thing that we can do as individuals. And in this line, there's the small family norm, and I'm talking one child family, not the Chinese model, but one child family norm. And this is a book by a colleague here at Hopkins speaking to that, because to counteract momentum, we have had to have less than replacement fertility. So the world scientists have warned us. This is an article of 2017. We've had we've failed to make sufficient progress since their first warning in 1992. We're jeopardizing our future by uneven material consumption, not perceiving rapid population growth as a primary driver. And down at the bottom there, time is running out. So, and this is 15,000 scientists have signed on to this. I'm almost done. So I want to give you this story from the Titanic. Now, maybe I'm like Paul Ehrlich, but I don't think so. And indeed, David admits we've got trouble now. They had a warning at 10:15 in the morning that there were icebergs. At 21:40 that evening, the wireless operator received a fifth and final ice warning about a large number of icebergs. And he treated it as non-urgent and failed to pass the message on. And about 2 hours later, the Titanic hit the iceberg. We have to be very aware that we are in trouble as a planet. So I encourage you to look at this book. It's a picture book by the Population Media Center. You have to sign in, but you don't get you get notices, but you don't get solicitations, as far as I remember. Anyway, I highly recommend looking at this book. I'll close with this. I teach an undergraduate class in the fall. And we have an economist speak in the last session and an ecologist speak. Are things getting better or getting worse? And we have the class vote. Do they believe the average person in 2050 will be better off or worse off? So these are the results this year. It keeps getting more on the worse side. 67% of my class felt in 2050 think the average person will be worse off. Do they know something we don't? The Earth with all its life is our only planet. So I leave you with this warning that we do need to pay more attention to our whole ecosystem. Thank you.
Thank you, Stan. After the discussion of the wager itself, after the reaction from you both, and we now invite John Bongotz and Raya Mutarek to comment on the bet through broader social economic and environmental context. John is a distinguished scholar and vice president of the Population Council. He will comment on the different views from the historical context and discuss the most critical issues related to the wager. John, you now have the floor.
All right, thank you very much. Let me see. Here we go. Is my slide visible?
Yes, great. Okay. Look.
Well, thank you for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be here. And I'd like to start by congratulating Stan for and David for this interesting debate and for Stan for winning the bet. Bets are like this are important to draw attention to big picture global issues. I've divided my comments into three parts. First, I'll put the current debate into historical perspective. As you already heard, the pessimists and optimists have been arguing with one another for many decades and many centuries, and I'll focus on the period from 1950 onwards. Then I'll take a look at critical issues that deserve more attention. The focus of the debates has been roughly the same since the 1950s, and I think there are critical issues that need to be discussed in greater detail in order to decide what actions to take. And then in conclusion, before I start with the debate, I want to summarize briefly the projections. These are estimates and projections from the United Nations. The population of the world stood at 2.5 billion in 1950. Today we have more than 5 billion more people. It's 7.8. And the UN expects this to go to 10.8 or so. Just 2 points about this. We are very much on the straight part of this curve. It's true that the growth rate has declined, but the absolute increments to the planet has been 75 million or so, 75 to 80 million per year since 1970. The growth in the past was dominated by growth in Asia. This is the green part of the curve. Much of the world, North America, Europe, are likely to see small declines. Asia, a little bit growth, but then a decline. By far, the bulk of future growth will occur in Africa, where the population will go from roughly 1 billion to 4 billion. This is a very serious problem in the continent where governments have trouble improving standards of living today. So let me now take you back to the beginning of this curve in 1950. And when pessimism about human welfare and the environment became serious. So this is phase one of the recent period from 1950 to 1980. It was right after World War II and much of the planet's infrastructure was in rubble. The huge numbers of refugees, massive poverty, government struggling to improve economies. And the mid-50s, the UN projection, world population projection, I said there would be 6 billion people in the year 2100. Many policymakers thought that was impossible. We had trouble taking care of 2.5 billion people. How could we live? How could the planet support 6 billion? The case for pessimism then grew stronger with the biggest famine in history in China in 1959 and 1961. That was a man-made famine. But the pessimist could say, we told you so. Then in the 60s and 70s, four important books were published, Paul Ehrlich, Rachel Carson, The Club of Rome, and the National Academy of Sciences. All of them were pessimistic about the future. And then, of course, we had the oil crisis in the 1970s, spikes in food prices and oil prices. And those of you who had driver's license in the 1970s, I'm surely stood in a long gas line. So by the end of the 70s, the pessimism peaked. This was followed by a period of relative optimism, which lasted from 1980 to 2000. And there are several reasons for this turn. The first one was that it became very clear by the early 80s that fertility declines were underway in Asia, Latin America, and North Africa. And a good part of that decline was stimulated by large investments in family planning programs. This is also the period we could then see that the population growth rate of the world was declining, even though the increments, the annual increments, were still high. Next, the Green Revolution spread around the world was a huge boost for food production, as you have seen in earlier presentations. The oil prices, which quadrupled during the 70s, collapsed, and by 1990, price of oil was roughly what it was in 1970. Next, decline in poverty and malnutrition in much of the developing world, and in particular Asia experienced spectacular growth. China and India are important examples. And as a result of this, population fell off the global agenda. Funding for population and family planning declined, and population no longer was a significant concern. But turn again occurred in around the year 2000, and we're in this period of rising pessimism. There are several reasons. The most important is the climate change has moved to the top of the global agenda. Global warming is very clearly happening at a rapid pace. 9 out of the 10 hottest days in a long time occurred in the past decade. And temperature trends are now close to the most pessimistic scenarios that climatologists have proposed. Around in 2005, I believe, the UN made a massive revision of its projection for Africa. And the reason for that is that the AIDS epidemic was then brought under control. The new projection expected the African population to grow from 1 to 4 billion. That is a quadrupling of population. Next, becoming clearer now that widespread shortage of fresh water, water tables are falling, rivers run dry, and all of this is very hard to turn around. It's not a simple matter. And then finally, biodiversity declines become substantial. We're losing many species, mammals, birds, frogs, insects, etc. So the point of this, the message of this quick review is that views of environmental issues have fluctuated over time from mostly pessimistic to more optimistic and back to pessimism. And the issues, the most important issues have changed. All points have dropped. For example, there's less concern now about non-renewable minerals, and new ones have moved up in the agenda, such as climate change. So here we are now, and in 2020, we have two very smart researchers, San and David, who clearly disagree. And the question is, why is this happening? How is this possible? And how do we decide who is right? The one important part of the story here is that I believe that there are critical issues that deserve more attention. And if we address those, we can get a better picture of what we can expect. It's important to emphasize that a debate is not just about facts. If you listen to David and Stan, you hear facts, and as far as I can tell, correct. So in order to settle or get more insight into this debate, we need to pay attention to how to value different outcomes. So the first critical issue is values. The optimists basically say that reducing natural capital to build human capital is okay. So if we have to reduce forests so that farmers can grow food and raise their families, that's fine. Essentially, what we're doing is we're turning natural capital into human capital. The pessimists, on the other hand, say declining natural capital is a problem for socioeconomic, health, and ethical reasons. And I think it's fair to say that many optimists don't value nature as much as the pessimists do. The second issue that I believe needs more attention is equity. There's too little discussion of who benefits and who gets hurt. We're likely to see large increases in inequality between countries and within countries, and the rich will do well and the poor will suffer. So from the optimist point of view, they say some rise in inequality is inevitable as countries' living standard rise. So the top will grow faster than the bottom. As long as the bottom grows, the optimists are okay. The pessimists, on the other hand, say environmental degradation mostly affect the poorest segments of societies, and increases in food prices are a large burden on the poor. You may recall the food riots that occurred in quite a few capital cities in the developing world during 2008, when food prices rose very sharply. And we could see that again in the future. Next issue I want to mention is black swans. The term black swan refers to a rare, unexpected event with severe impact. The Spanish flu and the COVID epidemic can be seen as black swans, and so can the Chinese famine in 1959 and 60. The optimists basically ignore black swans, and they see steady improvements in all these indicators with maybe a few bumps in the road. The pessimists, on the other hand, see the possibility of catastrophic events arising from climate change, disease with bacteria and viruses becoming treatment resistant, violent conflict, possibly even nuclear conflict, endocrine disruptors, etc. So the pessimists are urging us to take out insurance and don't walk up to the brink, because you never know when it is and how bad it will get. The final issue that I think deserves more attention is the weak policy response that we have seen so far. Policymakers tend to listen to economists, and economists tend to be optimistic. Particular optimists believe that free markets will largely take care of things and government intervention should be minimal. The Trump administration, of course, is an example, and they canceled many environmental regulations. The pessimists, on the other hand, say environmental degradation is largely due to negative externalities from economic activity. Strong government intervention is needed to avert disaster. And the problem is that governments have trouble dealing with externalities. A good example, of course, as we already heard, is dealing with carbon dioxide. We made little progress on that. And of course, politicians focus on the next election. So they don't want to spend time talking about things that happen decades into the future. My conclusion then is that Becker won the bet, and my guess is that he's likely right about the future direction of food prices. That is also the view of the IPCC. I believe that that's largely due to environmental constraints are increasingly problematic, and marginal costs are going to rise as we grow more and more food. Becker and Lamb both make important points, but critical issues are missing, in particular, I would say, equity. And they deserve more attention. And then finally, government action is urgently needed to limit environmental destruction and to ensure a growing food supply. The future is up to us. Thank you.
Thank you, John. This is a very enlightening. We now invite Roya Motorai to make comments. Raya is a program director, population and justice societies program at the International Institute for Applied System Analysis, and also director of population, environment and sustainable development at the Wittgenstein Center for Demography and Global Human Capital. Raya will discuss climate change and differential food consumption and food security from a demographic perspective. Raya, you now have the floor for 10 minutes.
Thank you so much, Raymond. So I want to make 3 points in my intervention. So the first one is I want to re-emphasize why demographic perspective is important when we want to understand the relationship, the nexus between population, environment, and food. And this bring me to the second point, why it is also important to look at the differentials in food consumption and food security. And my third point I would like to put on the table, the importance, the relevance also of considering the nutrition transition, which has been happening actually at the same time as demographic transition. And we haven't considered this point that much actually in our work on population and environment. So, and I would try to do this in 10 minutes, of course. Okay, so just go to the next slide. Of course, the relationship between population, environment, and the food system are much more complex than this simplified version that I'm presenting. We know that the population also have relationship with ecosystem, economic system, and political system, for instance. But I thought the simplified version would highlight better the centrality that the population plays in these nexuses. So first of all, we have heard already that population, our human activities would increase carbon emission and then have an impact on the climate and environmental system. And the changes in the climate system can affect food production. We've already heard from Stan about that. And also, of course, the effect of population on food production doesn't have to go to the change in the climate system, but also directly increasing in population, change food production and consumption pattern. At the same time, actually, the agricultural sector, so food production itself, also has an impact on the climate system, right? Because the agriculture sector alone actually accounts for, globally account for 13% of carbon emission. And this I'm only talking about agricultural sector, not yet accounting for carbon emission from food transportation, for instance, also food production and food industry. And through this channel, so through affecting the climate system, then of course the changes in the climate also affect the population. And also the change in the food system, the reduction in food availability, for instance, can affect population health. So now I have emphasized that population are the unit that is affecting the climate and the food system, and also are the people that are being affected by these changes. So what is important here is when we know the population trends, the current one and the future population trends, then we know how much of the impact population could make on the climate and food system. But at the same time, we also know how many people, or at least can try to predict how many people would be exposed or would be vulnerable to the changes in the climate system. But of course, it's not enough. In information, because it is also important to know where are these people going to live, right? So the population distribution is highly important, especially when we think about the impact of climate change. Though it's a global climate change, but the impact of climate change itself tend to be local. So we need to know where the people live. And this brings me also to another point I want to make, but also we know that the different subgroup of population also have different values and preference, different food that they eat, and also when they get affected by climate change, change in the food production, also I think John already mentioned the poorer people would be have less ability to adapt to these shifts as well. So the demographic perspectives are highly important here because we can do 2 things. So first, to provide empirical evidence so we can look at the differences between population subgroups, and also use this knowledge to forecast the future. So how the future going to be look like, how the climate system going to be impacted, and how the level of vulnerability would look like in the future. So we can forecast this through using population projections. But first, in terms of the empirical evidence, we know that population dynamics affect food production. But also, I just want to emphasize that because people of different characteristics also have different values and preference in terms of food consumption. For instance, here, we're looking at the differences in meat consumption. Right? So because we know that we have seen already actually that meat consumption has actually high contribution to carbon emissions. We know that it varies by country, especially the level of GDP make a lot of differences in the amount of meat consumed, but also within the same country, it varies greatly by different population characteristics. Across the world, actually, men tend to consume more meat than women. But what is interesting here that I want to point out, it's also the differences by wealth and education. Interestingly, in Canada and the US, there's no differences in what the wealth and the meat level of meat consumption. But what is interesting is the level of education. These are the data based on the data that were collected around 2015, 2016. So we noticed actually that it's a highly educated that tend to consume less meat than people with lower level of education. One could link level of education with highly educated tend to have higher concern about climate change, for instance, and also they probably have also higher concern about their health. So that could also be the reason. So apart from these demographic differentials in consumption, when we talk about another side, right, the impact of food insecurity, for instance, different subgroup of population, again, would have different ability to adapt or to respond to these changes. And there's a great heterogeneity also in this side. First of all, there's a heterogeneity also in terms of the climate impact itself. Both the dry wet, dry conditions, so less rain, and also the wet conditions can affect child undernutrition. So if we are interested in child, in children here. But the responses to these climatic shocks or rainfall shocks differ by country, and also again, different households would have different ability to deal with this rainfall shocks, which affect food production and can also affect food price and also the ability to put food on the table. So here in the case of India, what is interesting, actually it's not a positive interesting, but what is worth looking at is the differences in boys and girls. So generally, biologically, boys are more likely to be undernourished compared to girls because of the biological reason. Boys need more calories when they grow up. But here in the case of India, we actually observing that when the household experience excess rainfall, girls are catching up with boys. So it's not a good thing in terms of being more likely to be stunted. So we suspect that parents might have the preferential treatment to children feeding patterns when they experience rainfall shocks. So here, this type of knowledge is important because we know that we cannot just look at population as a total population, but we need to try to break it down because it differs in terms of the effect on the climate system, food system, but at the same time also in the differences in the response. So ideally, the population projection, if we can account for both spatial heterogeneity and demographic heterogeneity, which is very challenging because we want to go down into the lower geographical scales, but at the same time, keeping all of these differences demographic characteristics such as through the multi-dimensional population projection together. So it's challenging, but I think now that we have more data and better tools, so it's something that we can improve on that. And this would be my last slide, Levin. I just briefly touch upon the concept of double burden of malnutrition, because I think it's not new at all. It's actually in public health, people have looked at this a lot, but When we talk about malnutrition, malnutrition actually has two forms. It can be undernutrition, so undernourishment, and overnutrition. And in fact, obesity is recognized as an epidemic now. And what is challenging is when we have now the low and middle income countries, which face a double burden of malnutrition. It can happen in the same household, even in the same individual, when for instance, the mother might be overweight or obese, but the children are undernourished. So the policy to tackle these two forms of malnutrition at the same time is quite complex. So we tend to look at how climate change affects the population, but on the undernutrition side, but I think it's really important also to look at another side as well. So I'm gonna stop here. Thank you.
Thank you, Raya. This is a very important topic. And actually, people, have already raised a lot of questions concerning variations in consumption across a different group of people and food security for the urban poor. So I think your presentation gave a good answers on that. So now thank you for all panelists. We now open the floor for Q&A, you can use the function or raise a hand on the bottom of the screen, and from the third bottom from the right, and you can also submit your question through Q&A. We already see quite a number of questions submitted there. And for those who you want to raise your hand, raise a question, for the time's sake, please use a maximum 1 minute. So who wants to start? Maybe we can first look at the questions submitted through the Q&A function. And some of the questions are already, to some extent, answered by our panelists. But there could be someone, the questions are like, they already have interactions between the participants and also our panelists, and say about the wager and the weighting of the price index. Probably this is something like, surely you can also answer. And this is the question by Eric Stresslake on the weighting of the wager. And the question is something like, I read the question for you. I think this could be important for the wager. Surely, has the FFPI been calculated with the original weighting from when the grader started? Now, would the winner be the same with that weighting? And how much can increasing vegetarianism mitigate increase in population?
All right, a bit of a double whammy there. Now, in terms of the FFPI and the weights of it, I can confirm that the revised version of the index that was introduced in June last year is very much aligned to the previous version. And this is in part because the global structure of trade has not changed that rapidly between the original time of the wager and the timing of our revisions. So it would still confirm the same results. And this would also go if we looked at alternate versions of measures of global food prices, such as those global food consumption price indices that I mentioned earlier, which go to assess price movements, again, based more on a food basket perspective rather than trade. So on the whole, yeah, they would be confirmed. Confirmed, no change there. As to the second part of the question, that of increased vegetarianism, or in particular, the increased uptake or intake fruits and vegetables. Now, I had a peek also in there at some of the questions in the chat. I think that's a rather important topic. I think the various panelists looked at the, not only stressed the impacts of the demand on the supply side and food prices and the overall food implications. I think it's they did a beautiful job also in looking at some of the demand side aspects. I mean, in brief, what impact would it have on food prices? It would vary, let me put it that way, because food prices, again, you have to look at it from a sector but sector perspective, right? On the one hand, of course, it would tend to heighten a demand for particular products, and that, of course, with correlations as far as the production patterns and also input use, et cetera. And it would tend, presumably, to lessen demand for other more high-value protein-based products, correct? Keep in mind, again, however, one key aspect of the index, and particularly how we go about measuring prices at the global level, is that this is very much trade-based, right? Global trade-based. And keep in mind also that vegetables and fruits can often very much be traded, or rather traded at more of a local level. This is in part because of infrastructural constraints, and there the aspect of food waste, this also becomes very critical. So to what extent you would have this being passed through to the global picture, if we measure it from a trade perspective, is a little bit more relative, right? And again, you'd have to see how the relative forces offset each other and heighten demand for one particular commodity or a set of commodities, more in the fruit and vegetables, and diminish demand on the other side of it, right? And I think the particular question is extremely relevant also in terms of the nutrition aspect, right? And this is something the previous panelists that delve on very, 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 very well, in that often the demand for these products are very much correlated with income levels, right? So, and this is in part reflected also on nutrition levels. And so we would have to see also the corollaries from a food security perspective and how they would go about, let's say, impacting nutrition outcomes.
Okay, thank you, Shirley. And I think, David, you also want to talk about the distribution of food, right?
A number of questions. There are a number of questions about what about the distribution of food. So we look at these numbers for the whole world or for particular regions. What about the fact that there's still lots of people who don't get enough food? And that's a very, very valid question. One of the main things I want to emphasize is that these poverty estimates are directly relevant to that. So these poverty estimates are consumption-based measure. They're typically not based on income, they're based on consumption, so they take prices into account. And when we see big declines in these extreme poverty, this lowest level of this most extreme level of poverty that the World Bank estimates, and we find similar estimates from other sources, that really translates into improved food consumption among the poorest people in those countries. So there's still a lot of poverty left, but those big declines in poverty should be thought of as declines in malnutrition and underconsumption of food at the poorest levels of the population based on, you know, very carefully done household surveys. So we do know more about that than just these big picture, and there is quite a lot of progress being made. Of course, still much more work to be done.
Thank you, David. Nicole, remind me that Beth Fossil raised the hand, right? Okay, Beth, you may unmute yourself. Yeah, please go ahead.
Hi, this was a very interesting panel, and I'm really looking forward to seeing what comes from your discussion in terms of a future publication, hopefully. I really endorse John Bongardt's comment about how values are.
Beth, you want to unmute yourself?
Yeah. I really endorse John's comment about the importance of values. And I think that we've really focused a lot on facts and figures and the sort of the technical aspects of this question. And I wonder how we might put forward some of the more ethical questions. I think Ryan's comments were really a good start. And I also think that the contribution that David made to the Population Communication Fund is an excellent way to get started with promoting this conversation. But I'm curious to see how we can, what you all think about John's comments. Thank you.
Thank you, Beth. Who want to comment on the comments of John? Yeah, probably. I think we could invite Stan, right, and to make a comment on the comments.
It makes sense to me. Different values. I would like to make a couple brief points related to John and Shirley's presentation. But first of all, I think mine is more realistic than pessimistic. We're in a world where, as John pointed out, there's major problems, and we have to be realistic. And second is, both John and David showed projections to 2100. I tell my class not to use those because we know that very few of us will be alive, probably none of us in 2100, and very few of the people in 2100 are alive today. So it all depends on projections of fertility and mortality. And we've seen with COVID that mortality can change quite widely and fertility as well. So I say stop at 2050 or 2060 because most of us, many of us will be around in those years. But not 2100. Anyway, and the last thing I want to say, Shirley showed that food prices are high in the past 2 months, and they're probably going to continue to go up. I don't think David would bet for the decade to come because they're very likely to continue rising. And because of some of the problems that I showed and that John reaffirmed, global warming is very much with us and is affecting crops all over the world. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Well, I think I've been challenged. Can I just jump
go ahead. Actually, there is a question from the Q&A that asked you, David. What will be the price situation after 2021?
So just in case people missed the punchline, prices have been going down. They haven't been going up. They've been going down since 2011, since I gave my address. They just didn't go down as enough to offset the big increase from 2001 to 2010. So it was about the averages for the decade. So food prices have been going down, except as Shirley noted, for a recent blip up. And you know, you never know, maybe that's a sign of long-term challenges, but I think it's unlikely. And the reason I said in 2011 they were going to go down is there had been this big spike. It was getting a lot of attention, but there was a lot of reasons to think it was due to a lot of distortions in the world markets, to some real things like droughts and things, of course, which are very important. But the big trend, you know, the big trend is that food is growing faster than population. Population is the biggest source of increased demand. Rising incomes increase demand for food, but not that much, actually. People don't consume that much more food as their incomes rise. They do shift into meat and so on, as is well known. But the fact that food production is growing faster than population, you know, has to be a dampening on prices. So there are, of course, all these challenges of that climate change is creating. I don't want to minimize those at all. But, you know, we haven't seen those slowing down food production in any to any significant degree yet. And that's, of course, I understand the, you know, maybe it's just around the corner. But so I predict food prices are going to continue to be volatile as they always are, and they'll go up and down. But that the overall trend is to stay pretty stable, probably continue declining and not to have big increases upward. And maybe we need another wager to that regard.
Oh, thank you, David. Yeah, we have many, many questions now raised from the Q&A. One of the questions maybe, I could ask John or Raya to comment on. This is a question from JP Cohen. The population of many wildlife species have been declining. How much is that caused by lack of food available for them? So that's a complicated question, right? So Raya, could you go first?
Yes, I guess partly, and because animals cannot, wildlife or animals in general cannot adapt as fast as we can, right? So we know the 1 degree increase in the ocean temperature, for instance, the coral just die, for instance. It's a bit beyond just the availability of food, but the livable of the habitat, for instance, also make a lot of difference. So yeah. And plants cannot move. People can migrate, but plants, animals do move to the different zone, for instance. But of course, there must be some limits also to that. Yeah.
Yeah. Can I add to? Yeah, I think there's clearly the pressure of humans, particularly through agriculture, because we need more food. Forests are being turned into agricultural land. It's clearly true in most countries. Brazil, soybeans is an important international market, and the Amazon forest is being cut down. The same is true in many other countries, and this is one of the main sources of loss of biodiversity. We're basically less and less nature and more people. If I may, while I have the floor, could I make a point about the issues that David raised?
And please go ahead.
I'm saying that, pardon?
Please go ahead.
Yeah. You're right that the prices have come down, but the FAO just published a 2020 State of the World Food book, and I quickly looked at it. And they claim that the number of undernourished people and the proportion of the population undernourished had its lowest point in 2014 and has since risen. So undernourishment as measured by FAO is actually rising right now. The FAO also provides an interesting new figure. I haven't seen this before. Undernourished means that you don't have enough energy to work. So most people who are the 690 million people who are undernourished mostly get by living on staple food, rice, wheat, etc. The FAO has now calculated how many people cannot afford a healthy diet. They calculate what they call the least expensive healthy diet. Which includes a variety of foods, fruits, vegetables, and a little bit of meat. And the FAO claims that more than 3 billion people cannot afford a very simple, healthy diet. I don't know whether that number is going up or down, and maybe someone can help me with that. Any case, the situation doesn't look very as good as you, I think, David, depicted.
Nico, you have something to say?
Yes, one comment. We can go a bit longer than scheduled, so we can take an extra 5 minutes or 10 minutes or so. But there are a few people several people in the raise hands category, and I'll allow one to talk if you agreed, who is also in the Q&A. Patrick Beaujot, you are now allowed to talk. Be short, please.
I will. My background is in agriculture. I'm from the Canadian prairies where the breadbasket of the world, we call it, and I'm a proponent of modern agriculture. My concern about food prices and food supply is that there's a lot of pressure, and we see it in EU. They're not allowed to grow genetically modified crops, which has increased the yields quite a bit that David's shown, and our yields have increased through modern use of products like glyphosate that the EU is also considering banning. And the EU is talking about a certain percentage of their crops should be organic. I wonder how that will affect food prices and food supply. Thank you.
Thank you. Who would like to answer that one? Shirley, something for you?
Sure. Sorry, I seem to have lost my background. That's a rather complex topic to talk about. I think the question is very relevant, particularly as far as the role of technology in bolstering production capacity, really in moving the curve forward, if you will. Now, in terms of the sustainability of it, of course, the arguments behind such moves are, on the one hand, because of the environmental sustainability, on the other one, also because of consumer preferences or some consumer-related apprehensions, particularly as far as the GMO crops are concerned. I don't have a straight answer for you in that particular case because there are various positions on the topic, some of which actually are of the view that the imposition of very stringent environmental or sustainability criteria, particularly as far as input use goes, could cause a considerable decline in production, whereas other views essentially pretend a substitution effect. In that a lot of that production would essentially relocate elsewhere. Keep in mind also that countries in the world itself we're not islands unto our own, correct? Particularly if they're well integrated in global markets. Also keep in mind, particularly if you come from an agricultural perspective, the implications that such moves may have potentially, and here I'm not really taking a position, in terms of costs, right? Raising costs, and potentially also with implications in terms of the accessibility of these supplies. And all of this also needs to be seen from an overall income perspective, right? On who can actually afford to pay these type of enhanced supplies. So unfortunately, I don't have much of a straight answer there, but I hope at least I have provided a bit of guidance on the various factors that may be at play.
Nicole, anyone else from raising hand?
There are several, and maybe one last one. I'll just pick Jordan Klein. You can ask your question now.
All right, great. Thank you so much. So I am a relatively newer demography PhD student. So this is a really interesting talk. And one question I had for the panel that's related to some of the research that I'm doing is, so Professor Becker referred to this anticipated population collapse as the impacts of climate change intensify. So especially the demographers on the panel, but anyone can contribute to this. So, or what are your thoughts on where we may expect to see these spikes in mortality, as in like specifically thinking of causes of death, and where, what might be some potential warning signs that we might be able to see in the mortality data now in terms of climate-related mortality?
Thank you.
Thank you, Jordan.
Stan, would you like to react to that?
I think John put his finger on it. We really don't know.
Oh sorry.
We really don't know what's going to happen in the future. We have these major catastrophes that can happen in terms of famine, for example, could be on the horizon. We've got conflicts that could rise. We've got millions and millions of people are pushed from their homelands because of drought and that sort of thing and rising water. So we don't really know. It's hard to plan for these kinds of spikes that may happen. So, you know, Ehrlich got in trouble because he predicted famine for the 1990s or whatever. So I'm not going to say there will be, but certainly there have been famines, and it looks like that could be in our future with global warming. And one other quick thing I want to say, let's stop using the words climate change. It's climate crisis. Change is neutral. You change clothes, you change jobs and that sort of thing. We have a climate crisis, folks. Thank you.
Thank you, Stan. Raya, John, anyone want to comment on that, on the question?
Oh, and now that Stan said don't use the word climate change, so I cannot advertise anymore. I actually have the project. Of course, it hasn't started yet, that would look at the impact of the changes in the climate system on population dynamics. So trying to unpack these three components, so fertility, mortality, and migration, because I think at the moment we have some knowledge about that particularly the knowledge on the historical climate trends, right? So we do know in sublocation, population subgroup, for instance, heat wave hit more the elderly, and then maybe for climatic shocks might hit more the younger one in terms of infant mortality, for instance. So that we know migration is on the mixed side. What we don't know actually is now the historical trends of the variation in the climate we observe, it's up to 1.2 degree that changed. But in the future, we are unfortunately going towards 1.5 or even 2 degree. How much the people could adapt, because we know people can adapt. So that's the uncertainty in that side that we have to imagine a bit the future, but I'm trying to unpack all of these things. So hopefully in the next 1 or 2 years can answer some of these questions. Thank you.
If I may, I'm not a person who believes in a collapse of human population. I look at the future more in a way of muddling through. The muddling through will be harder the more people we have. Every billion people we add to the planet makes life harder for everybody else. A related point, I think the well-to-do, the rich, will do perfectly fine. They can buy themselves places where there's no worry about ocean rise. They can always get food. But a very large proportion of humanity will have a very difficult time over the next few decades. And of course, the environment. We are destroying the environment to keep humans alive.
Thank you. I think this... Nicole, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say probably the same as you. This may be a very good time to, or a very good note to end this discussion, although it's a very... very challenging note that it's time to take care of all the environmental challenges and criticism that are approaching us. So I hate to spoil, but I think it's time to close this discussion, this debate, as for now at least. It was very rich. We had some very great presentation. I would like to thank all of you for doing that. I would like to thank also all attendees for their active participation in the discussion. And sorry again that we couldn't deal with all your questions. I think it's time to continue this discussion. We will not stop here. IUSSP is ready to facilitate further discussions. One first option would be, of course, to do this at the International Population Conference, which will convene in December in virtual, but also partly in India. I think that would be a good place to continue the discussion. Mind you, the call for submissions is still open. It ends 15 May, so you still have time to put in your abstracts. Maybe one of the thoughts is that a new bet to focus attention and to raise attention to the issue would be something to think about. And maybe then on other resources, like our ecological resources, could be a possible bet. But I think the discussion needs to continue. It will not stop here, but unfortunately, we will have to stop this webinar. Thanks again to all the presentations. Thanks to our great moderator. And thank you again for attending this seminar. And stay tuned and follow us at the IUSSP website for new activities. Thank you very much and enjoy your weekend.
Thank you.
Bye.